The show where anything goes. Motivation, mindset, recovery, philosophy, and life. We become who we are through what we experience. We all have a story. And this is My Backstory with Josh Boyer.
My Backstory podcast, and I'm here with Syn Martinez. I'm super pumped, man, that you're here, bro, and I want you to do a little introduction for the listeners to let everybody know who you are, what you're about, kind of a little bit about yourself, like a brief introduction.
Sure. I am Syn Martinez. I created this company called Afro Vitality in 2008. Incorporated in 2010, ran a CrossFit gym from 2008 until 2015. Been a corporate guy up into that for about 25 years. Suit and tie guy every day, and I was like a three-piece suit type of guy with the suspenders and the bow tie. I was ridiculous, man.
Yeah, man.
But, it was a good journey, man.
So
there we go.
Thank you, man. I appreciate that. So the way we linked up, just for the listeners, so they know, it was actually through tragedy. And So Rory Hamill was on my podcast, and what's crazy is after Rory's passing, I had reached out to one of my buddies, Danny Clancy, who was the first episode that I did. And I was like, man, I really feel this calling to like do something bigger and better in terms of mental health in the veteran community. Like, I feel like a strong calling to do something. And I don't really know what. He's like, man, why don't you do a 12-part podcast series specifically covering mental health? And I was like, yeah, man, that sounds awesome. Well, what's crazy about that is, like, I didn't know why he said 12. I don't know why he said 12 part. It could have been 13, could have been 5, could have been whatever. But he just said arbitrary number 12. And I thought when he said it, he knew why he said it. But he did. We talked about it. He's like, no, I had no clue. But anyway, so, you know, those 12 steps in the AA program, which Dan and I both happen to be sober. We're not part of AA, but it's kind of funny that it was 12 podcast series, a 12-part podcast series. And then Rory was number 12 on my, he was the 12th episode on my podcast. Yeah. And I was like, wow. So it was kind of a, you know, I'm all into like symbolism and stuff like that. And it was almost like it was meant to be. So how are you doing, man?
You know, I wrestle with it, man. You know, In the extent of Rory's life, man, I was like a millisecond. You know what I mean? Like, I was just I don't know, dude. I don't even know what to call it at this point. So there's days I feel guilty for feeling like this. You know what I mean? And then there's days that I feel celebrated, you know?
Yeah.
This sort of goes back and forth.
Yeah.
But it's a good day. It's been a good day. It's been a good day, man.
You know what's crazy is I've been starting every episode with asking people how they're doing. And, you know, I do that on purpose because a lot of people are going to give you a bullshit answer. You know, like, I'm good. Things are cool, you know. But, like, they're really not going to give you the nitty-gritty of what's really going on internally most of the time. And my hope is by asking that question and diving a little deeper and saying, like, hey, man, are you good? Like, is everything cool? Like, what do you have going on internally? Like, what's going on with you? So maybe we can dive in a little deeper on that. Like, how did Rory's passing affect you?
Well, two main things. Three's kind of hit me this week more than any other week. It hit me a little bit last week, but a little more this week. So, you know, one, he's the first suicide, man. It's funny that I grew up in the suburbs, of course, and my story was that I was kind of gravitated more towards the city.
Right.
So though we lived in these particular places, I was a little bit more into what was going on in the city, if that makes sense.
Yep.
So you know, I was around some real criminals, man. Like, I was around those real guys. Yeah. And it's a little bit more, I don't know what the right word is, it's a little bit more anticipated that someone's going to get shot. That's, yeah. Yeah. You know, we lost so-and-so. Yeah, yeah, that's my dude. You know, pour out a little liquor. Yeah. I don't know, man. But this is just a little different, you know? You know, I'll be 50 this year. I'll be 50 in November. And the second part is, like, I don't know. It's sort of like, I don't know, man. I guess, you know, he's my fourth. And what I mean by that is I put some posts up, one on Twitter, a few on Instagram, that, you know, because of who I was in the CrossFit community, who I am, I pretty much know everybody. Everybody knows me. So when someone passes that's of some kind of stature that's local to the tri-state area, man, I get called first.
Right.
I'm one of the first calls. Not only do I get the phone call, I get the, okay, we got to program the workout. Okay, we got to do the T-shirt. And, you know, so I'm up nights on end just designing shirts and stuff, man. Roy was different, you know, like, I barely knew his last name, man. Like, I just called him Rory. That was my guy. And then he let me call him Lucky, you know, so I started calling him Lucky, and that was my guy. So, you know, the third one is, like, I'm really starting to understand that, you know, our relationship was important. It was important to me, but it was important to him because it wasn't based on who he was as a military individual. You know, it wasn't based on anything he had done. You know, we just kind of vibed on illustrations and drawings. Man, we love fucking skulls and reapers and stuff. We just, and some of the same music as well. And, you know, we just kind of bonded like that, dude.
How'd you guys meet initially?
What's that?
How'd you guys meet initially?
So Derek Carver's been following me for about 4 years, I believe, on Instagram, and he kept tagging me and shit. You know, him and I, you know, we talked several times, and we just got a good vibe, man. This is great. And Rory just started, you know, he started following me and then posting stuff about, you know, something I did or something, whatever. I was just like, wow, man, what's up, you know? And, you know, I don't necessarily go to someone's page and be like, okay, this guy is fucking this type of person. Like, I'll just kind of be going through my DMs or my mentions or whatever, and I'll just go to someone's page. I'll at least put some fire on there or some a skull or something just to let them know that, I'm acknowledging them, you know? So right. I used to do that with Rory all the time. I would acknowledge him, like, hey, what's up, man? Thank you for posting that or whatever. And we just kept talking and kept talking. And then, you know, because I follow people, I really follow them. Like, I don't fucking pretend I follow them. I really follow them. So I'll like something or I won't like something or I'll comment on some shit.
Right.
So he was doing some of those things. And I was doing some of those things for him. I kept seeing him in, going from Jersey into the city. I kept seeing him going to the city, in the city, in the city. I'm like, motherfucker, if you're in the goddamn city, you better fucking pull up or tell me yourself. What the fuck?
Yeah.
And he just started laughing at me. I was like, come on, man. Don't fuck around. When you're in the city, you better fucking tell me. So he got better. I mean, you know, he didn't get good at it, but he got a little bit better.
Right.
So finally, you know, that event came up, that Veterans Day event, and he... I saw him with a video with it, and I was like, God damn, man, that shit is fucking cool as shit. He was like, Syn, you want to come? I said, what the fuck are we talking about, for real?
Yeah.
So I had to send him my driver's license and all this shit. And then I brought camera people, man, really, because I wanted it on record that I was fucking shooting machine guns in America legally, you know what I mean? Right. Like, I wanted to fucking prove.
Yeah.
And, of course, I was going to talk to Rory, man. That's my guy. So it just turned out, you know, this would be the first and last time I ever see him. So there we go.
Yeah, man, that's a trip, dude. I hit him up on Instagram when I started the podcast and was like, you know, I wanted to get him on and share his story. And a lot of people that I reach out to on Instagram, it's hit and miss, you know, if they have a big enough following. Sometimes their DMs don't even go, like, to their inbox, you know. It's like, you got to
right.
– I'm even seeing it with my – yeah, I'm even
– funnel that shit.
Yeah, I'm even seeing it with my inbox now where it's like I'll miss messages and be like, oh, shit, there's, like, someone in there trying to message me and I didn't see it. And so with him, like, I reached out to him and was like, yeah, I'd love to have you on the podcast. And, like, immediately was like – he was like, yeah, I'm down. Let's do it. And so – the way I built the podcast was I travel directly to whoever I'm podcasting with. So I'll fly out there, drive if it's somewhere close to my house. But most of the time I was flying. So I flew out to Philly, then drove into the city to stay with one of my buddies who I was in the military with, who works for New York Fire Department. And so then the next day I met up with Rory in Jersey. And something about that guy, man. He was such a special dude. Like, there was something so incredible about him. And I was taken by him, man. I was like, dude, this dude is a special person, and he's really going to leave a huge, like, positive impact. He's going to make a huge positive impact in the world. And he did. And the podcast, I mean, was amazing. We went out after, had dinner and stuff like that. And he was just that guy that was always checking in. You know what I mean? He'd always hit me up and be like, hey, man, how you doing? You know, and so a week before he took his life, he sent me a message and said, hey, man, I just want to check in with you. How you doing? And I was like, I'm doing all right, man. You know, things are cool. You know, this COVID shit's got me a little anxious, but, you know, I think I'll be all right. It's all good. How you doing, man? He's like, oh, life is good. You know, and it was short, but it was like enough for him to check in with me, me to check in with him. But something I felt like kind of guilty because I should have, like, it was kind of a random message from him because I hadn't heard from him in a while. I was like, man, I should have saw that sign and been, like, reached back out and be like, man, are you good? Like, is everything cool? But, you know, there's nothing I can – you can't go back in time, obviously, and change any of that. But, you know, I don't know. What are your thoughts, man, on this whole COVID-19 as far as, like, the effect that it's having on people that have mental health issues? Do you think that played a part in Rory taking his life?
I think I heard the first part, but I don't know if that was a two-part question.
Yeah, do you think the COVID-19, like the lockdown and stuff like that, do you think that played a part in Rory taking his life?
The COVID-19 is clearly unfortunate. We're all suffering in some particular form or fashion.
Yeah.
The way a person had said it to me was they were talking about AA, and they were saying that these guys – they go to AA meetings, they would have it totally scheduled for their day. You know, they go to the 8 o'clock or the 6 o'clock or whatever and go to work. And then, like, they had a routine. So this has stopped a lot of people's routine in terms of mental health and recovery. So it's definitely affecting all that need that type of stimulus, if that makes sense.
Right.
And I do believe that being in your house a long time, or, you know, being inside all the time and not necessarily getting exposure with other people definitely played some part in this. I just don't know if it was quote unquote the trigger, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know if anybody will ever really possibly know, but I don't know if that was what, you know, really set him over the edge.
Yeah, and the other thing too is, like, with the alcohol, you know, I don't know, I saw a post, you know, someone said, I'll bring the booze or whatever, and, you know, in the last post that he put up, and he was like, yeah, bring it, you know, this and that. And
yeah,
I'm thinking that, you know, it's been talked about on the other two episodes I've done, so I'll, you know, talk about it now. It's like, I think, you know, it's like I almost want to make it a challenge within the veteran community to challenge people to stay sober for even if for a little bit. You know what I mean? Like, do it for a month, do it for 2 months, do it for three, see how you feel. And I'm not the sober preacher guy, man. I'm not going to go around telling people, I've been sober, and so, like, you should get sober too. Like, I'll still go to bars and hang out with my boys. Like, I don't have an issue with it. But I feel like if Rory was drinking, it's a depressant, you know what I mean? And, like, people, your inhibitions are different. Your judgment is off. Like, things are not, you're not thinking, obviously not thinking properly. And had he been sober, I don't even know if he was intoxicated, but if he was, like, would there have been a difference if he was sober? And so I think there can be an argument made, you know, that sobriety is probably a good choice for people who are suffering from mental illness, you know, or mental things going on. Have you ever personally yourself, have you ever thought about suicide, attempted suicide, or been to that place?
I've been there a few times, but not, I don't know, man. It's a weird place. You know, I don't think, I could be totally wrong, man, but I don't know if anyone hasn't thought about it before.
Right.
You know, I've never planned it out. I've never, I could see why someone would do that, you know, to kind of just end it now and start over or just end it and whatever happens, happens after that. I mean, I can understand that the depths of that darkness. I've seen it, I've touched it, you know, I didn't live there clearly and I didn't plan anything out, but I could see getting to that point, you know, just feeling totally trapped and maybe a total disappointment or maybe wanting to just end your story now on your terms.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's crazy. Suicide's a weird thing, man, because when I was younger, you know, I used to have a lot of judgments about it, you know, like, oh, people will commit suicide or, you know, weak in the mind. You know, they're selfish. They're leaving all these people to pick up the pieces after they're gone. And part of me still feels a little bit like that because I'm angry. You know, it's like, fuck, man. You know, like, what could I have done to, like, stop this? But the other part of me is more compassionate. I have more empathy for where people are in those dark places. And I think when I was younger, I think I knew subconsciously even that, like, I could just as easily go to that dark place and just as easily be exactly where they are. And you know, looking back on my life, it's like I look back at some of the things I was doing with all my opiate addiction and drinking and this and that. It was like I was trying to kill myself. I wasn't saying that out loud, like, oh yeah, I'm actively trying to take my life, but I was making choices in terms of drugs and alcohol that I would go to bed hoping I wouldn't wake up. You know, like I'm gonna take all these drugs and hopefully it'll be done. You know, I could be checked out and done. And it isn't until I got older and got sober and started really looking back on some of those things and be like, damn, man, I was in that spot too. You know, so who am I to judge? What are your thoughts on suicide?
You know, I don't have a very huge frame of reference for it.
Right.
I've seen it in all types of different ways. I've been hearing about it more and more for the last, you know, since Roy's passed and me posting and stuff like that. A lot of people have reached out. I mean, I guess growing up with it, you kind of thought, if someone was like a teenager or something like that, maybe that was just depression and anxiety and things that weren't dealt with. As you got older, you know, when you start thinking about someone actually like taking a gun to their head that, you know, is in military or police or whatever it may be, for them to deal with that trauma that way, it's gotta be crippling. Do you know what I mean? Like,
right.
To the point where you feel like this is a record that you want to stop playing in your ear all the time. So I think it's, you know, it is forever, you know, in terms of how we view that. Yeah. And I think that that's not how people should, in their life or their story or how that works. But, you know, as hard it is to live with it, I would just have to assume it would be that hard enough to do.
Right.
But you're just, even if you got to the point of that emotion just overcame you that much that you actually followed through with it, I'd have to assume that it's just as hard to do it as it is to try to live with someone that has done it.
I agree, man. And I, you know, somebody brought it up on one of the other episodes that they use the word courage, you know? It would take a lot of courage to actually go through with it. And I don't know if that's a good choice of word or whatever, but it makes sense for me because it's like, it takes a lot of balls, man, to take yourself out, you know? And you got, like you said, man, you got to be in a place where it's, you know, the pain of taking your life is less than the pain that, you know, you're dealing with on a day-to-day basis. What are some things you think we could do in terms of mental health to like stop some of these senseless like suicides? I mean, what do you think, like with Rory, we talk about Rory in specific, like, do you think there's anything you could have done, I could have done, or anybody could have done to like change that outcome?
you know, I put a lot of pressure on myself. And I've thought about this question at least 100 times, you know, and I just feel like the mere fact that I was there in the capacity that I was in his life, I feel like, you know, maybe not enough trust was established, maybe not enough open communication. I felt like for myself, I was a little walking on eggshells, you know. This is once people started telling me who he was, and I'm watching all these, you know, not all these, but I'm watching this film put together, and I'm looking at some of his older posts, and I'm like, damn, man, I guess this is like the real thing, you know. Yeah. You know, it's almost like dating a chick that you feel is out of your league. You know what I mean? You're going to maybe, you know, you're not going to check in as much. You're going to try to look a little more cooler. You know what I mean? You're going to try to, you know, do what you can to not overplay yourself, you know? So I felt like I was doing that a little bit, you know, not necessarily checking in, but I checked in. Hey, how are you? How's everything? You know, it was interesting. He didn't answer the phone. You know, last time I talked to him, he usually answers the phone, you know, when I ended up having to text him. So, yeah, I don't know. I stopped reading his messages, man. And then I went back and looked at some, and it was one literally at the end that said, I want to die. I said, wow. Oh, fuck, did he really just say that shit?
Yeah.
You know? If I had seen that, I'd have called him immediately, dude. I wouldn't give a fuck what time of the day it was. I'd have been like, man, you can't even act like this is okay. Like, what are we talking about?
Yeah.
So, I don't know, man. Those are the things that run through my head. You know, if I read his posts, if I had maybe checked in more, if I had stopped, you know, acting like, you know, because he is who he is, I wasn't good enough to talk to him, you know. Yeah. And those are the things that I wrestle with.
Yeah, he never had, in my opinion, you know, never had that pretentious, like, persona about him. You know what I mean? Like, never even believed his own press. I don't think he realized how powerful he really was and how much he was, like, doing to, like, change so many people's lives. I mean, he was saving lives. And I don't think he realized the magnitude of who he was. And that's unfortunate, you know. And I think a lot of people always say, like, you know, when you're in that place of mental despair or whatever, it's like, hey, you know, just reach out, you know, call a brother before you make a decision. It's like, a lot of times when you're in that dark place, you don't want to talk to anybody.
Yeah, and it's the last thing you want to do, and call, it's like, somebody.
So we need to put the burden of responsibility.
What you'll actually say out of your mouth, you know?
Yeah, we need to put the burden of responsibility on us, you know, where it's like, I should have been reaching out more. You know what I mean? If there's people that I, because you could, you could look into, like you said, when you're actively following somebody on Instagram, it's unfortunate that, like, social media has, like, kind of, like, taken place of, like, actual human interaction because just of kind of where we are. But I could still look at social media and know if somebody isn't doing okay.
I have intuition,
you know? And it's like, I think it's our responsibility, you know, like, as humans, you know, and as people to check in with people, man. If you know that somebody's not doing well, like, fuck, man, check in with them.
I think, you know what, I'll take it a step further. I'll say, you know, guys like myself with big social media, listen, man, backings or audience, it's your fucking job to answer all those fucking messages, man.
Right.
And whether it's telling them to fuck off or telling them thank you, you got to do it, man.
Yeah,
you have no idea, man. I said, you know, this guy today, earlier today, I told him I would say something about him.
Yeah.
But he sent me this message, man. He was just like, listen, man. He said, you're such an inspiration to me, man. You keep talking about Rory, and it makes me want to talk about the things that are bothering me, or the loss that I've had, you know.
Yes,
and it was just crazy. And then at the end of it, he said, I know you'll never hear this. I just wanted you to know. I'm like, what the fuck are we talking about?
Yeah.
I fucking, like, but dude, I said, thank you. You're welcome. And I said, man, you have no idea, man. I answer everything. I don't give a fuck, man.
Yeah.
I remember I got my first suicide thanking, I guess, if you want to call it that. Someone said, you know, I was in a real dark place last night and I was thinking about ending it, and I fucking went to your page and you literally saved my life. I said, fuck.
Yeah, fuck. Dude, that's heavy.
Like, you done took what I was trying to turn into some fun shit and just, you know, you made it a job, but you made it super real. Yep. You know, these are people's lives, man.
Yeah.
You could save us with these larger followers, man. You could probably literally save someone's life if they say, I'm having a bad day, and you actually said, talk to me, and actually gave a shit. Dude, you have no idea, man.
Yeah, I tell people, man, I have my personal cell phone number on Instagram. I don't care. People can call me. I'm available 24/7, you know? Like, I might not always answer my phone. I might be asleep or whatever, but there's always somebody that's awake that's willing to answer that call. And I can't even tell you, man, with a podcast, you never know who's going to hear your message. You never know who's going to be listening. And I've been pleasantly surprised multiple times by people reaching out, doing just that and saying, like, hey, man, that episode that you did, like, changed my life. Like, thank you so much. And it's like, you know, dude, like, it's not about stroking my ego. It's more about, like, it makes me realize that I'm on purpose, that I'm doing exactly what I was intended to do, because it makes me feel a certain kind of way. It's not an ego, like, hype thing. It's more like, wow, man, I'm making a difference. And to me, that's what's most important, you know?
I mean, I always looked at it like, not necessarily a job, a duty, but more like something that just needs to get done, man.
Yeah.
Like, if we all just took that fucking few seconds and just took care of the people that are around us and the people that reach out, we do our best for. If all of us just did that small little shit, man, the world would be a different place.
Absolutely, man. In terms of social media, what are your thoughts on social media? And as far as, you know, do you think that social media is detrimental to people that have mental health issues, or you think it's a more of a positive than a detriment to having it?
I've got several thoughts. One would be it has its pluses, you know, but it also has its, you know, I'll never forget my neighbor. She showed me, like, all these different hashtags for anorexia, you know, and she was like, I don't know what they are anymore, but she knew all the, you know, like all the acronyms, all the, you know, so it can feed those demons too. Do you know what I mean? Like, there can be some healing done. You could see something, you know, you could read something and you could feel 10 times better than you did. And then the opposite could happen too. You could see some shit and it just ruins your entire day.
Right.
So it's there for, you know, a purpose if that's what you want it to be. And at the end of the day, you still have to use that free will for better, and then you will get the best out of it. But it also has that other side. It's also got those demons in there too. So you can expose that as well. But, you know, that's why I tell people to purge, you know, like, you're following those pages, you know, don't make you feel good, you know, make you a little jealous or envious or whatever. Get rid of that shit.
Yep.
You know?
Definitely.
I do it myself, man. It's been hard because there's people that I love, man, and they either not talking about nothing or they just talk about, you know, some otherness, and it's just different, man. So I tell people, you know, social media will be what you want it to be. It can be the best thing ever, or it can be the worst thing ever. Both demons are there.
Yeah, I agree, man. I think they're, in terms of mental health, though, I think that I kind of think it's more of a detriment. And the only reason is that, you know, like, granted, like, doing me having my social media really helps me to get my platform where I need, you know, my reach where I need it to go. Without social media, I wouldn't be able to reach as many people. So there's definitely some positives that come from it, but you kind of lose that human interaction. Is one of the things that I really, like, hate about social media. Is, like, I really want to connect with people. That's why when I started the podcast, you know, I could do podcasts like this where it's like which is cool. You know, I'm doing it over Zoom and it's all good. However, like, I loved doing podcast. Like, I did 85 episodes all in person. Not one of them was done remotely. And I loved it.
That's how I want to keep it too, man. I hate the Zoom shit. That's why I stopped doing mine.
Yep.
I hated all that Skyping and all that, man. Yeah, I'd rather be there person in the, you know, in the flesh with the person.
Yep. And the other part was like I got the ability to see people authentically, like who they really are, you know, like,
right.
And that's the thing with social media is like, it's, you know, it's tough because you see people on social media, a lot of people are looking at other people, like you're always looking for, or most people are always looking for a savior. They're looking for somebody to look up to. They're looking for some inspiration, motivation, right. Whatever. And a lot of times
they're not looking inside.
Right. They're not looking inside. They're also like it's a huge
distraction, dude. Yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. Yeah. You know, it's a huge fucking distraction. And again, you know, I agree with you. You know, mental health should be more about being out and about.
Yep.
You know, and getting that experience of being around human activity or, you know, other human beings. I get it.
Yeah.
More of a
realness, like not a comparison. Because I think that's part of it, right? Where you see like a guy like, for example, Rory being in the military and, you know, getting a Purple Heart and all these things. And he's like, he's crushing it. You know what I mean? He was crushing it. He was going around like giving motivational speeches and doing all these other things. And then you have other people that they've had really hard lives and they're taking that hard life to turn it around to be like a positive force in the world. But then in reality, they might be a complete piece of shit. You know what I mean? Like it might just be social media. It might just be this game that they play. And I think it's dangerous. You know what I mean? When you have social media where you can portray anything you want, you know, you have this person looking up to you being like, man, I want to have that Ferrari and this and that. It's like,
right.
That Ferrari doesn't belong to that dude. You know what I mean? Like he used it for the Instagram post, you know, and you're looking up to this guy and it's kind of misleading. So I don't know. Mean,
again, it's got its good points and it definitely has its bad ones.
Yeah.
In terms of mental health, I don't know. I mean, what I was going to say was, you know, it's here. You know, it's just like the invention of the television and the video game. You know, we heard all these things from our parents, you know, don't stand too close to the television. Then it was those video games are going to rock your brain and all this stuff. And I've seen both of them do amazing things in the opposite direction. So it's like, you know, to a certain extent, it is what you want it to be.
Yeah.
But I agree that there should be a lot of, you know, human interaction.
Definitely.
And this does provide a deterrent, but in same respects, it's really how I met Rory.
Yeah, for sure.
So it has its drawbacks, it has its success stories, so to speak.
Yeah. What do you think, like, when you've gone to your dark places, you know what I mean? What helped you get out of that? Like, if you could share anything with, like, somebody who's listening to this episode, like, if they're in a dark place, what's some of the best things that you do to get yourself out of it?
Well, so I study myself, man. Like, this is totally anti anything I should be saying, right?
But no, it's all good.
I really don't read nobody's books, man. I've read a few books in sales and marketing. When it comes down to the autobiographies, of course, I had like Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, those types of memoirs from Black Panthers, you know, Soul on Ice and stuff like that, ISIS papers, so on and so forth. But I don't, I really just study me, man, you know? So to a certain extent, I try to study things that could happen,
right?
So I try to prepare myself for the inevitable, you know, some things that are inevitable, like being in a relationship or let's say having a child. And then I try to prepare myself for possibilities. You know, what are some of the possibilities that could happen, good or bad? So let's say some darkness comes in and that's usually after some success, right? Like I made some shit happen, bam. And then all of a sudden it's like everything went to shit or some bullshit like that, right? So, you know, I really more and more understand that with a lot of rain comes sunshine, you know, with a lot of failure comes success, with a lot of darkness comes that enlightenment, you know, it comes to that other side where the more darkness you've dealt with, two things happen. You can relate to other people and their levels of darkness. And then you got a supreme kind of awakening or enlightenment that happens as well. So, when I'm faced with something that's dark, I have enough reference points, dude. Like, I have enough experience where I can go back and say, yeah, this sucks, but remember we overcame that shit. Oh, then right. Or, you know, this sucks, but, you know, remember when we did that? Oh, right. My bad. So I have ways to go back and just kind of big myself up and say, well, we've been through worse than this, you know. Or if this is, like, the worst that's happening as we're going through it, we also realize that there's going to be another side to this. It's going to be over. So that's one way. The other is, you know, having good people around you, man. Like, people that you can count on, you know, not people because posturing or, you know, they know this person, let me not network with them, and, you know, not no network and shit, like some real, you know, I could tell him exactly what's on my mind and not be judged, or I could tell this person or that person or that person. Like, we need that too, you know. We need that ability to call someone when we're feeling a particular way that is just going to listen and not try to give us advice. You know, maybe they're just there to listen. Yep. Maybe they're to listen and flip it around. But so those are most of the things that I deal with. The other thing is I deal with, is that me? The other thing I deal with is just challenging myself, getting those little bitty wins all the time, so that when some adversity comes in, I know I've dealt with, you know, this before in heavier ways. And that's pre-darkness, right? You got to kind of do the pre-darkness work where, you know, not everything's going to be perfect. You know, you've lived long enough, you know that certain things are going to happen and untimely times. You know, how are you going to respond to that? How are you going to deal with that? And I don't know if that makes sense, but that's sort of what I do.
No, it makes perfect sense. And I think one of the things you brought up that I think is important, especially in today's day and age, is that listening is like a skill. It's kind of something that you need to learn how to do. And I shared this story last night, and I'll share it again, that I was at a men's retreat, you know, with a bunch of dudes. And during that retreat, the facilitator asked one of the guys in the group to point out two people in the group that he judged the most. And I was one of the dudes that he pointed out. I'm like, man, what the fuck, dude? Why does this dude judge me? And I didn't say anything at the time. I just kind of let it go. And it's like, he judges me. I don't know what for, but that's his judgment. It's all good. And it was bothering me, you know? So I was like, you know, I got to ask this guy, like, what's that, you know, what that's about, you know? And we were both in the Air Force and shit like that, too. So I thought we had some kind of connection. So I was like, that's kind of weird. Like, why is he judging me? And so I asked him, I was like, hey, what was that about, dude? And he's like, well, you know, when we were over there talking, you know, earlier in the day, we were over by your car and we were talking. I was telling you this really deep story and you were completely checked out. Like, you weren't, I could tell, like, you weren't listening at all. Like, you were, like, on your own, like, tip, like, kind of just, and I was, dude. Like, and when I thought back on that conversation, I was like, I totally wasn't present at all.
Right.
And so I thanked him. I said, thank you, man, for bringing that to my attention. Because I think a lot of people are so guilty of that. And not only are they guilty of not listening, the people that are not being listened to intuitively pick up on it. And it feels like shit. You know, when you're talking to somebody, it's like, if I'm talking to somebody, I'm trying to share my deepest, like, stuff with them, and I can feel that they're not with me. It's like, fuck off, dude, I'm done. And I just shut down. I was like, I'm good. So I think this should be a lesson to all of us. Anybody listening to this episode, like, really ask yourself, man, when people are trying to talk to you, are you listening? Are you really listening?
Are you just ready to talk?
Right. I think a lot of people were all innately narcissistic in a little bit, you know? So we want to hear our own story. We want to, like, share our own stuff. And that's all good. I'm not saying that's all bad, but there's times when your attention is warranted. Like, you need to give that person your undivided attention because they need you at that moment. And you can lose that opportunity. Like, if I wouldn't have gone to that guy and had that conversation about why he was judging me, I would have lost the opportunity to grow. I would have lost the opportunity to learn something about myself. Like, wow, dude, like, thank you, man, for letting me know that, like, I wasn't listening to you, man. That hurt you, man. You didn't like that. That wasn't cool. And so I'm going to do my best moving forward to not do that to people.
You noticed, you went and asked him, so you were willing to accept the information.
Right.
Yeah. Sometimes in a situation like that, if he had barked on you, you probably wouldn't have heard anything he had to say.
Right.
But because he chose to do it a different way,
yeah,
and you pretty much waited most of the day to go and ask him what he was talking about, you were ready for that information. You were willing to accept whatever it is he was willing to say.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure. Nah, that's good shit, man. What's the best way for people to connect with you? If people want to get in touch with you?
Instagram's pretty much the best.
Yeah. And go ahead and plug your handles.
Oh, I'm Avid Brutality, and my personal page is Mr.Syn. That's spelled S-Y-N.
Cool, man. Well, nah, man, I really, really genuinely appreciate you being willing to come on the show and to share, like, your thoughts, to share what you got going on, man. And, like, I was feeling every single one of those posts you were putting up about Rory. And you put something else up there about people unfollowing you for missing your friend. And it was like, man.
Isn't that crazy?
Like, what is wrong with people? You know? And I think that's part of the issue we have, like, in society is that people don't, it's like you're not even allowed to grieve your own way. You know what I mean? People are kind of like dictating how, oh, like that's too much. Yeah, you know what I mean? You're grieving too much, you know?
I mean, it's, you know, it's slowed down, but it ain't over, man.
Yeah.
I'm almost at 1,000. I don't know, man. I don't know. It's just weird, dude. It's just weird. You know, us with these followings, you know, we're under a different type of pressure, man. We're literally looking at those numbers because,
right,
you know, for me, it's just amazing. You know, I started this 5 years ago, man. I might add 7,000 followers, you know. Right. And I went in this direction knowing, wasn't sure what was going to happen, you know.
Yep.
Then I remember getting to 10,000 and thinking, oh, my God, I got fucking 10,000. Then I remember hitting 20 and then 50, and then it was like, this is out of control.
Yeah.
But we don't know if it's bots. We don't know what's the point, but we lose and gain followers every time we post.
Yeah.
It's almost like a weird experiment of pleasing versus being yourself. You know, do you do things to please, or do you do things because you're pleasing yourself? You know, or are you trying to please others? Yeah. So it's weird. You know, I've gone through this a few times because I've gone in different directions, in terms of my content. And your audience are literally the ones that are rocking with you today. Like, it could change tomorrow. So it is what it is.
If you could give one message, like one last message to the listeners, like whether that be, you know, what you want your legacy to be, or a positive message, an uplifting message that, you know, can leave the world a better place. What would that message be that you would want to share?
I usually don't do it in the form of a message. I'll do it in the form of a challenge. I will say that each one of us has something that's very unique that we can bring in, you know, to the situation, you know, to the community, to the nation, to the world. And I just challenge everyone to try to figure out what that one thing is. You know, we have unique fingerprints, we have unique skulls, all these other things. I'm guaranteed all of us has at least one unique thought. And I challenge you to try to figure out what that is, nurture that, and grow it like your child.
Love it, man. Well, thank you again, brother. I really appreciate you, man. If there's anything I can ever do for you, please feel free to reach out,
you know, man.
And make it happen. Thank you so much, brother. Talk to you soon.
All right, be good.
Thank you for listening to My Backstory. Stay motivated and stay connected off the show. Follow at my_backstory_ to be a part of the journey to recovery and to see where your story goes. Or visit us online at hereismybackstory.com.